Okay.
And here we go. Thank you guys for being patient. We are going to start with our first tactical. New teacher, Sandra Mancias. We have Mr. Osvaldo Cantu, our other sped teacher, who has been in this department for the past, remind me, I'll say three years. And Brenda Gonzalez, assistant principal. I oversee the department. And so a lot of things that we're gonna discuss today, guys, this is our tactical document that we usually use, Sandra, when we have meetings. We try to do this at least every two weeks so that we can update any information, look at our next steps, making sure we're following through with all the things that we need to as far as our priorities and things that we need to do for the kids. So usually we start with a team builder, but we're just gonna hop on over and start with our agenda items because there's a lot of information we wanna go over. And the first thing that I'm going to put, we each have a role. So for today, I'll be facilitating most of the meeting. But if I can have a timekeeper just to keep me, if you can be timekeeper, Sandra, and then Ozzy can be note taker on the things that we're discussing. And if there's anything that, and I'll remind you of this because I know it's gonna take getting used to, but whenever there's like a next step or thing that we need to make sure that we take care of before our next meeting, we're gonna put it under, I added your name under Ozzy's.
Oh, yes.
And then you'll usually put like your priorities just for this week, like what are the things you're gonna focus on? And then where it says next steps, any next steps that you'll have to do for this upcoming week. So I'll remind you of when to add those, just so that you get, you know, comfortable using the doc. So the first thing, like we can start with our first item, is our data board. And so this, Sandra, was something that we shared at BOYPD. Yeah, we can put 6 minutes on here. So there's two different things that I want to show you. First, this little snip, I just took a quick snip just for it to be here and quick, easy access. But this includes all our data back from 2020 to 2021, the year after that, and then last year's data. And so you can see, well, let's go ahead, let me give you guys just 1 minute just to look through each subject and the results. So we can just be silent for just a minute. Anybody like to chime in and share their observations and what they viewed here?
Well, there's a huge drop off from like 2020 to 2021. We were at a huge increase, I should say. We were at a 20 SAS student achievement score, and on 2021-2022 school year, we hit a 28 student achievement score, which is great. You know, we improved a lot as a campus. And then with the new STAR exam, you know, this past year from 2022 to 2023, you do see a decrease in our student achievement score of a 22.6. So that's the trend I saw. We were a little bit low, we went up, and now we decreased a little bit.
Yeah, and just to explain a little more in detail, Sandra, here, so we weren't tracking by approaches, meetings, masters here. We started here, and this will tell you, like for example, sixth reading, three out of the seven met approaches, and then the approaches, meets, and masters. And so when we average all of these numbers up, that's how we get our SAS. Okay. Anything that you saw, Sandra?
Same, how the drop was not as low as it was in 2020-2021, but it was lower than the previous year.
Yep. And so some things I can say is many different things, right? We had the change in STAR. We also had two new teachers last year in the department, which we're gonna have again, right? But we were still able to meet the district goal or close to, it was right, I'm saying that we met it, we were there at the 23 SAS as a department. But something else that I noticed was our struggle in middle school. I think that's gonna be our biggest area to push, especially because our eighth graders have four STAR tested subjects. Our eighth graders currently take algebra and biology, which is usually courses that they take in high school, but they take those EOCs as well as the eighth grade reading and eighth grade US history. So really pushing on those, especially because we have high numbers of students in those grade levels as well. And something to think about is we do have a lot of new teachers also teaching the content in the STAR subject area. So they're gonna need a lot of support to keep pushing these results. When we get into our EOCs, we have more of our veteran teachers. We have Ms. Campos and Nancy in English 1 and 2, and you can see, you know, pretty good averages there. US history, our students usually always do well on that exam because the level of that content is AP aligned. So this, when they take the STAR test, it's fairly, I'm not gonna say easy, but it's just easier than what they've been doing all year. So they've been doing really well in the US history. And the only reason why we were, I think we were pending just one passer in May was because she was absent the day of the test. Otherwise, like it shows there, we did have 100% as soon as she took that exam. Any questions on this? And so the other data board that's going to be really important is if you click on Unit Exam Data Middle School. Here is where you see all our students for each grade level. And you can scroll, well, this is for middle school, right? So you can see all the middle school students. You'll indicate which unit exam it is. And so it can get very tricky with English 1 and English 2, just a heads up, because I know they're testing this week and we're gonna have to input the data. But they have a unit exam, and then they have one they take in the middle that's called LA 1 or 2. And I think they're taking one this past week. So it's not a unit exam, but one that they take in between. And so just being, you know, paying close attention to the name of the exam so that we label it here correctly. And then we put our student results here. And you can see that Aussie's color coding as far as approaches, if they're critical, and they actually change these color coding. So approaches would be.
If you move up, yeah.
Yellow.
Scroll
yep.
to yellow, seven, six and
green,
seven grade.
Six, seven grade up here?
Yeah,
yeah
right there.
Right.
So approaches is yellow, means is green, masters is blue. But what she was trying to tell you is that if you look at, we scroll back to.
There's also orange.
Yeah, for did not meet or critical.
Yeah.
You see how on ELA it says LA1, LA2, and then the module?
Here.
That's, yeah, on mine. That's what you're going to have to look for when the students are testing.
I did see a message, no, but I was at it.
Yep. So, any questions on the data board? And it's just going to be really important that we just continuously update this on when they do test, right? So the easiest thing, I think, and Ozzy can correct me if I'm wrong, is to ask the teacher for the results. And if not, then they can show you how to pull it from EdSite. And we can do that if we have some time after going through the items, how to pull it. On Locus also is where we can pull that information.
Do you know what approaches means and masters means in detail? Or would you like rather to kind of just go over it?
Yeah, we can go over it.
Okay, you want to go over these approaches and masters?
So approaches is basically like the standard of them passing the test. Means will indicate that the student is passing at grade level. And then masters, of course, pass like surpassing the grade level requirements for the exam.
Okay. Yep.
And yep, so the only ones or colors that we're missing over here is the orange, which comes right before the approaches. So like those are, we call sometimes our bubble kids because they are capable of pushing through and meeting approaches. And then you'll see red, like when they're really critical. And so we can check real quick, yours would be under unit exam, high school, data, let me see.
It's gonna be under tactical information, right?
Yeah.
And this is where we'll track, or continue tracking. Now, when we get, we're also a few weeks away from the students taking their mock exams. And that's happening, it usually happens the first week of December, or right after, the second week, first second week is when they're either retesting for our EOCs and their mock testing. And so that would be a separate tab, and you'll see it where it says, it should say mock exams.
It's MD, right, because we haven't taken any, but we'll update as soon as they do take some.
Yep, and when we come to that, we'll like discuss each placement of where the students landed and what are we gonna do to push those kids to the next level. If they're critical, then pushing them to the orange. If they're orange, then pushing them to the yellow. Just specifically talking about all our kids once they take that exam. Okay, so for here, as a next step, all you'll have to put, since your students do have a test this week, is you'll put right here on next steps, input English 1 and 2 exam scores, or unit exam scores, or LA exam scores. I'll get out of the box.
Input. And then that's for this week, right? And also just calling parents.
Yep, we're gonna, that's actually an agenda item.
Okay.
So number two, I put IEP meetings. I wanted to make sure, so I'm gonna go ahead and go to that tab, IEP meetings, and I know you guys have already looked and discussed, but just to make sure that we're not missing anything as far as what IEP meetings are coming up.
Yeah, so for Amber and Emery Gomez, they'll be done tomorrow. So this would be 11:01. So normally what we do, and then would you like for me to kind of go over it or you kind of want to walk her through?
Yeah, as far as paperwork and all that, would be complete?
Yeah, like tentative date, IEP date.
Yeah, you can explain.
Okay, so on the IEP date, I kind of went over this last week with you, right? We see the date and then the due date. Okay, so it's pretty much a day difference. The students should be in order from 6 through 12. At the very bottom, there's some that are new students. The evaluation date is there too for whenever we need to do a read. Notice how most of our students already have a tentative date. We would like to backwards plan, right? That way we prep with time and send teacher and performance to teachers. And also schedule IEP meetings within like 3 weeks in advance, right? So normally what we do is we put a tentative date, we put the paperwork should be completed a week in advance. So the ones that are coming up right now, Amber and Emery Gomez, those are already done. Nancy Montalon was also another one, those are done. But I just kind of want to take a minute to take a look at the ones that we have for this semester, and we can start planning those that we kind of have an idea of what you're going to have to work on. And then if you're going to need support with that, so we can support you too. Okay, so we'll take like a minute.
Yeah.
Just take a look at the due date specifically for the high school grade levels, like 8 through 12. And let me see if we can find the two students or four students that are have IEP meetings coming up. It's pretty easy because they're kind of in there.
I know, right here. Well,
okay. If you can just name them.
Viviana.
Okay.
Bono School.
And what's the due date for Viviana?
Viviana is due on the 30th.
Okay.
The 30th, so.
So when would you, when should we like prioritize that? I have a tentative date on 11/27. Are you okay with that?
For the meeting?
Yeah.
Yes.
I just kind of want you to get practice, right?
For paperwork, we would do it 3 weeks before.
A week before.
A week before, but schedule with teachers, send out the paperwork, then
So if the IP meeting for Viviana is on the 27th of November, right, you schedule it, when will you turn in paperwork for this?
A week before.
Which, what would be the date for that?
The 20th.
Right, and in this case, that'll be next break, so the 17th. Perfect, so you kind of got the hang of it, right? So whenever you're done and you complete the paperwork, you put the paperwork there, you check it off in green, and then also you just cross them all out in green, right? That means that the IEPs have been completed, and we no longer have to worry about those anymore, okay? The ones that you should kind of focus on that's coming up is Norma Jean, right? Hers is 11/13, so by when should you send out teacher and performance? When, and also when should you complete the paperwork for that?
For Norma Jean, we should already be sending out the teacher forms and submitting paperwork by the 6th. I mean, or have our paperwork ready for our meeting on the 6th.
Yeah. Well, let me see. Yeah.
We need to submit our paperwork to teachers.
Yeah, which I kind of
need for.
Cool, so you kind of already know how to do all this, right? So this is what you'll be going based off. So always look at it so that you can backwards find it. Okay.
And so since she's the next one coming up, I would just put in your next step, we haven't sent off the invitation, right, or did we?
No.
I got it already.
Okay.
So I can work on it.
We can do that, yeah. And so just put out the next step, complete invitation for, and just put her initials, N-E.
So on the next steps, wherever you take the walk over, you can do that, yeah.
Okay, awesome job there, guys. Let's move to tactical item number 3. I put SPED collaborations. So what I want us to start doing is, and I think Ozzy already, he already has the specific times of when he meets with his core teachers, and it's usually math and reading that we prioritize first. So what we need to start doing, Sandra, is collaborating with our ELA, right? So like Jen, and it would be Evelyn for 11th grade. And then math would be Anna. And for math, for now, is Victor Lopez. So priorities would be our ELA. So Jen, which we have already, right? We did earlier last week or when you started. And then I think Evelyn is the one that we would need to touch base with next to figure out plans. And so I can also copy and paste my little, what it looks like. You'll be sending a calendar invite based on when the teacher's off so that you can meet with them on a weekly basis.
Okay.
And especially with Gompos, because she's the one that you're gonna be getting all your resources from to help you with what you should focus on in your class. Am I gonna do, you know, what she's practicing in class, or am I gonna kind of adjust more to STAR, you know, level TEKS, just depending, right? And she'll tell you what would be best. And so I put it here. I put kind of like what the agenda should look like. So when you meet with them, like one of the very first things that you should be looking at is the data. How did they do on their last exam if they just recently took one? What were some of the gaps? And getting that information. Then you start discussing based on that data, what are the students of concern? Wow, like this student, you know, really scored super low. I think we're gonna have to, you know, either communicate with parents or have a meeting or increase tutorial time or add in a supplemental aid, whatever it is that, you know, we're needing to support the student. And then you'll get into their lesson plans. What is she going to be going over? What does it look like for the next week? So that you're able to either internalize your own, but also know what she's doing in the class. And then it goes to the fourth item of, okay, what supplemental aid or graphic organizer can we include or come up with? I know Nancy has her acronyms here of what she uses for her essay. Sometimes they input more than what they would want our students to complete. I know we kind of like took out a few parts on Gompos' graphic organizer,
mm-hmm.
and our students were still able to pass based on that, right? Like them able to just write an effective essay,
mm-hmm.
Or at least get a 2 or even a 3, and then do well on the multiple choice. So it just depends. But also looking at that to see what would be best for our students. And then at the end of the meeting, you just wrap up with your next steps. Okay, you know, you tell her, I'm gonna go ahead and create this so that it's ready for next week, or she'll say like, you know what, I'll go ahead and take this off for them, or whatever it is that you all are gonna adjust based on their accommodations or modifications of what they need. Okay, so there's the collaborations. The next step would be, Sandra, we could just do this first for Campos, is deciding what day and what period you guys would be meeting. I know that she's off 2nd and 7th for high school. I think 7th is usually the best time that she's able to meet, but just deciding with her, like, okay, what day, so you all can get that invitation up and going again.
I know that for the schedule I have right now, I have it for today, class period.
Okay.
Yes, but I'm gonna reach out to her to see if that's still okay with her.
Yep, and let me see if it's on my calendar. So all you would do is just, because I think the previous ones were canceled, you would just add it, yep, you would just add it in here. You would create an invite once, and you can ask her today, it doesn't have to be today, like if she's comfortable with the Tuesdays at that time, then just send it reoccurring every week for the remainder of the year. Any questions on the collaborations or agenda steps?
I'm actually, no, we're good.
Okay. The next thing that I would, that I was gonna show you, Sandra, and you can make copies of this. We have this is actually a form that when HQ comes in or when leaders go into the classrooms that we use to observe, but it's also very helpful for us. And so this is a copy for you. I'm gonna try to find the soft copy. But basically what it is an observation form to go into the general education class. And you can see there, it has the first boxes that includes the areas that you're looking for, just for gen ed teacher. Do they have access to accommodations? Yes, like usually we know, like, oh, they have it in the, you know, in the filing cabinet, or, you know, or wherever it is that they have it. The seating chart posted with their pathways. The exit ticket trackers, are the students engaged? Differentiated instruction, a variety of instructional strategies. Are they using the audio? Are they using videos? You know, what are they using in the class? Anchor charts are those that are up there. I think you're familiar with the anchor charts, where things posted, right, to help students process the information. And it would be just a quick yes or no, in your low inference data. 4 out of 5 students are engaged, or 2 out of 5 are engaged. All others have their head down, like you're writing your little notes of what you observe. And then we have the portion for sped teachers. So if I'm going in there as a leader, I can go and write all my notes for the general ed teacher, and I can write also my notes for the sped teacher that's in there. So same thing, usually when you go in, and this is very helpful for you, of what you need to have when you're in the classroom. Mm-hmm. I know we've kind of just been going in, getting to know the kids, where are they, what periods, but now, your focus is going to be your PowerPoints or lesson plans for period 4, right, that you have them, but when you go to the other classrooms, what's going to be very helpful from this list is your exemplars. And so I'm going to give you access to all the lesson plans so that you're able to pull those, but you can also get them from the teacher if, let's say, they haven't uploaded it in there. You just quickly go ask them, like, hey, do you have your exemplar? And you're able to have that on your clipboard to go and check, like, okay, how are the students doing? Are they mastering, are they not? Is there a gap, you know? And then at that point, you make your decision, do you need to do a pull out or whatever it is. So in your hand, it should be the teacher exemplar. That's something like we're gonna go and like, we're gonna check with you as the SPED teacher and how you're supporting the students. They have, if you're working with different students, right, it doesn't only have to be ours. You can help and assist others that are struggling. Are you checking to make sure they have all the materials? If they're missing, like, their calculator, if they have that accommodation, or whatever it is that they're missing, you make sure they have a dictionary or whatever it is. Just all these other items, right, is what we would be checking for. Our binders and accommodations, oh, we'll show you the snapshots, we haven't talked about that, right? Our binders are electronic. Does she have access to those already?
Yes.
Yes, so that and those are probably what we, at our next meeting, we'll have to really set some time to look at and update because we've had a few meetings already. But it has all the teachers by grade level, the students that they have and their IEPs. And that was something that we shared at the beginning of the year with all their information and accommodations included. And then here just sharing, you know, the glows and grows for each teacher. So it's a very helpful tool, especially if you forget, like, what do I need to take or what do I need to have? Like, just look back at this, but also for you to write your notes if you need to. When you collaborate with the teacher, like, oh, what was I going to tell them? You know, I forgot what feedback I had or what I was going to share, for you to also write notes if you want to. Any questions on this?
No, this was helpful, especially for my section.
Okay, and then our next let's go to the next big one, is our schedule of minutes. So if I go to, what would be helpful to look at here, Ozzy, just our holistic kids, the schedule, that's this one, or would be more helpful?
Yeah.
This one? Okay, so here is the schedule where we probably need to pop in these next few days to service the kids.
Your schedule on your left.
Yeah.
This is your
yours.
Okay. So, English 2, right? What time is that? I can't really see it. It's a little blurry. Is it 10 to 10:45? There you go. Right? English 2, 10 to 10:45. Are you available from 10 to 10:45 any day?
10, yes.
Okay. What day are you available?
Oh wait, no, 10:58, I get out of, I'm with Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, I work with ELA for geometry, Tuesday, ELA, Wednesday, I have something going on that, from 9:58 to 10:58. And then
what we can do is we can have you support Tuesdays and Thursdays in English 2. From 10 to 10:45. For now, given the situation that we're in, once our other teacher starts, things will go back to our time. Okay? So that way you can also get another glimpse of like how Ms. Cabales teaches, the strategies that she uses. It's kind of the same that Ms. Cabales, but it's different, right? Because it's a different, it's English too. But I think it'll be more practice for you.
Okay.
So for 9:58 to 10:58, you're pretty much going to be doing ELA all week.
Okay.
English 1, English 2, English 1, English 2. Friday, you can step into pre-calc or geometry.
Okay.
I think we got that. So on your next steps, we'll be doing English 2 in class support third period.
These last two baby items are just, with testing and everything coming up, Sandra, one of the things that we highly push, and we're actually going to, I'm going to meet with Deanna today about our accelerated learning program that is still going to be continued, and what that means is that our students who haven't passed the STAR have to complete hours, if you remember from the previous years, of the 30 hours or whatever it is they have to complete for that subject that they didn't pass. And so I'm going to get more clarification as far as how we're going to be documenting that, if it's going to be the same as last year, what students do we have on that list, and we can go over that at our next meeting. But aside from that, our students usually do need to come to tutorials. And so that's something that we communicate with parents and that we communicate with them to be present. I know Campos has already started again with hers, and hers are on Mondays. I don't know if at this point you are wanting to lead any. I know sometimes they would have her one day, but then we would have a separate one where we would really just go over practice or star takes or something that they didn't complete in her class, like on a Wednesday or on a Thursday if they didn't have to stay for math. So just something to think about. With mocks coming up, we are going to really want to push and support our kids these next few weeks. And it doesn't have to be every day, but usually at least one day, whether you're going in there and supporting Campos, or you're coming in here and supporting Cabrales, or you're having your own tutorials.
On my own, it would be, you mentioned like things that they weren't able to complete.
Either they weren't able to complete, but the biggest thing is those star T's.
Okay.
Practice. Questions, annotating, or using the scratch sheet of paper where they have the story on the screen, screen to scratch. They're practicing the steps of what to do is something we also can do. Another thing that we could do, which was a part of a plan that I'm creating, is having them have practice time on the online assessment. I feel like we didn't do that enough last year, and had we had, like how they're doing FedPlus, all these mocks and practice, I think our kids need to continue practicing. They can choose any exam, biology, reading, history, just to see what it looks like and how they access all the accommodations online. And we can go over that too at the next meeting of how to use those things and maneuver through the online assessment. It's all online. Everybody has access. So that's something that we can also do at a tutorial. And I think we only have, I want to see, and I'll check, one Saturday school. We might have more now that we're having to complete hours. I'm going to probably say there's probably one in November and one in December, a Saturday school. So again, another opportunity to help and support the kids, because they usually do all come, as long as we're communicating with them and communicating to the parents. So with that is the last item, our call logs. I know we have our call log here. I go to Ozzie's. The date, which students, and then the reason for the call. But my push is going to be that we now start inputting this information into Frontline, because Diana, or you know, the personnel who is checking our paperwork at the end of the quarter, you know, we're missing that information in there, and then we're also stuck inputting all that information before the quarter ends, and I don't want you all to have all that to put into Frontline. And so best practice would be, when you do make a parent phone call, is to input and document into Frontline.
Is it okay if I show up real quick?
Yep.
All right, so you want to get the way you normally do, right? Mm-hmm. You go to our forms, you click on whatever student. On the same drop down, you just put parent. So
I would do it there
for
one.
So we've been doing this for the past years, right, where we document our own log here on our tracker.
Okay.
But now they're pushing for us to do it on
okay.
eSpin.
And then we have
which,
to
and I feel like this is more work, but I think this is better if we get used to this.
That's just we usually make, our department has always been very good at communicating with parents almost on a weekly basis. Sending snips of their grades and where they're at, what tutorials are coming up like every week, or at least bi-weekly. I used to send, like I would just take a picture with my phone of PowerSchool, all the students' grades, here's where they're at, progress reports are coming out, or we have tutorials, you spend in your classes, whatever it is, or if it's a positive, you know,
message.